Go ahead and get started. Thank you everyone for coming to tonight's sustainability dialogue hosted by Sustainable Claremont. My name is Stuart Wood. I'm the executive director here at Sustainable Claremont. We've had a ton of dialogues in the past few weeks, so we're very thankful that you're all coming to join us tonight to talk about sustainability and our water resources. I just have a couple really quick announcements before we get going and before I introduce you to our speaker. First is that we are in the middle of our year-end giving campaign. This is the campaign that we have annually to raise funds for things like tonight. So if you're willing and able to throw a little bit our way to help pay for these types of programs, we'd really appreciate it. Got a very ambitious goal this year to raise $15,000, and we're about a quarter of the way there. So we're excited that we could hit that target, but we do need your help. So my colleague Han is going to go ahead and drop a link to that into the chat box if you're so willing. And we've been having just a ton of dialogues, and we have a ton of events coming up in the new year. We're going to be planting in Pomona. We're going to be planting in San Bernardino at schools. We're gonna have some plantings in Claremont, Rancho Cucamonga, just all over the place. And a bunch of dialogues coming up too. We're gonna have one with SoCal Edison and one on the Clara Oaks project in Claremont. And so to keep it ahead of all these projects and to just be clued into to what's going on, easiest way to do that is to sign up to our newsletter. And so Han is gonna go ahead and drop that too, a link to that in our chat box. And please do consider signing up for the newsletter. Sometimes if things change, like the Zoom link change or the time of any of these types of events, it's easier for us to notify everyone via email more than it is over social media. So just a good way to keep connected. Before I introduce our speaker, I should note that this is sort of the second part of a two-part series on water in Southern California. A couple weeks back, we had a really great dialogue with Rebecca Kimmich. And I'm gonna go ahead and drop a link to that dialogue in the chat box if anyone's interested. That was a conversation about the sources of water in Southern California and some of the big issues with water conservation and just water management in the area. So please do watch that if you get a chance after we have our conversation tonight. And we're hoping to talk a little bit more about very hyperlocal water issues here in the new year. Okay, so let me go ahead and introduce our speaker. So tonight we're gonna be speaking with Rupam Soni, who is the Community Relations Manager with the Metropolitan Water District of Southern California. She was responsible for serving as a community liaison and engaging the public for many metropolitan facilities, initiatives, and infrastructure projects. Much of her work involves outreach for the Regional Recycled Water Program, the Metropolitan's first in-region water supply, and she is dedicated to making a difference in California's water future through her work. Rupam is an active member of the Water Reuse Association and leads their communications collaborative group. She's also a member of the Board of Advisors for Grades of Green, an environmental nonprofit. She has over 20 years of experience in the water and wastewater industries and is a registered civil engineer who has a BS from UCLA and an MS from UC Berkeley in civil engineering. So Rupam, we're so excited to have you tonight, and I'll go ahead and throw the mic to you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Stuart. And thanks to all of you for joining us here for this conversation on this Monday night where it looks like it's about to rain. So very timely here. And I thank you for putting Rebecca's link into the chat. I actually was able to join and listen to her. Rebecca's one of my colleagues. We work in the same group together at Metropolitan. So I was able to hear what she shared. So I might reference some of that. If you didn't hear her presentation, it's totally fine. I'm not going to go into too much detail on what she covered, but definitely watch it. It was really interesting, and you can see some of the challenges that we face in the water industry through that discussion there. So a little bit about what I'm going to talk about today. I am going to give a little review on the Metropolitan Water District, and I am going to be talking about our regional recycle water program, which will provide a new supply of water for the region, and kind of go into the details, the nuts and bolts of the program, and what we're planning for the future. And then I'm happy to answer any questions you all might have. I'm willing to stay as late as needed. I get really excited when people want to learn more about the program, so I never turn down questions. I will also provide my contact information. So if you think of something tomorrow or next week, please feel free to reach out to me anytime. So as Rebecca had mentioned a couple weeks ago, Metropolitan is the nation's largest water wholesaler. So we provide water to our 26 member agencies, who you see here on this map, extends all the way down from San Diego up to Ventura County, out east to Riverside County and San Bernardino County as well. Our service area covers 19 million people and 5,200 square miles. And if you are from Southern California, none of this sounds incredible to you, but just for reference, 19 million people is the population of the entire state of Florida or New York. Those are the third and fourth largest states in the country. So we're supporting here a $1 trillion economy. That's the 13th largest economy in the world. And our water supplies are very, very interesting and complex. And we're going to get a little bit into that. But first, I want to also acknowledge your member agency, the Three Valleys Municipal Water District. And today with us, we have Director Brian Bocock, who's here, who represents Claremont and Laverne, and then Matt Litchfield, the general manager. So thanks to both of you for joining today. Three Valleys is also a big supporter of this program, one of our partners on this program. And so we're really excited to be able to work with them. And Rebecca hit on some of these things in her presentation, and she went much more in depth than I'm going to go. But the challenges on our imported water systems have been really interesting, for the lack of a better word, this past year. We have always in Southern California been drought prone. So that's something we've always planned for and prepared for in our water supplies. So we import our water, we import it from Northern California, we import water from the Colorado River, and then we also have some local water supplies from our member agencies. So groundwater supplies, recycled water supplies. And so these are imported supplies. They provide over half of our water here in Southern California, generally, most years. This past year was just incredible, not something we expected at all. So it wasn't necessarily a dry year. There was definitely precipitation, there was snow in the mountains, there was rain, but that water, that snow never made its way into our reservoirs. So usually that snow melts, goes into rivers and lakes and heads down into reservoirs, it's captured, and then it comes down to us in Southern California via our aqueduct system. So our Colorado River aqueduct, our State Water Project aqueduct. This past year, we didn't get so much water from the state. We actually ended up this year, just a couple weeks ago, getting an announcement that we have a 0% allocation from the State Water Project. We do expect that to change. It's great that there's rain coming in here to Southern California tonight. There's been precipitation and snow in Northern California as well. So that will change, but our reservoirs hit record low levels. And then it was one of our driest years on record. And then on the Colorado River system, our reservoirs hit the lowest level. Like Lake Mead, our major reservoir in the system, hit the lowest level it's ever been since we started filling the reservoir. And this is the impacts of climate change. And we expected these impacts to come, but not so soon. And so this is something now that we're going to have to continue to plan for. But I don't want you to worry. We have been planning, all of us that work in the water business have been planning for our water supplies since the start of growth here in Southern California. So after the gold rush, after people started moving here to Southern California, and it was clear we needed additional supplies to sustain that growing population, the Metropolitan Water District was formed, and we constructed the Colorado River Aqueduct that continues to provide water to us today. And then again, after World War II, when there was another population boom in the area, we invested in the State Water Project system, which brings in water from Northern California down to Southern California. And then in the 80s and the 90s, when the region grew even more and it was clear that additional water supplies were needed, we made investments in our local supplies. So we did that by starting a local resources program where we would give funding to our member agencies to pursue local water supplies. And we also invested heavily in water conservation. And maybe many of you have taken advantage of our conservation program. So if you've torn out your lawn and put in drought-tolerant plants, we offer rebates for that. If you've bought a low-flow toilet or a high-efficiency washing machine and you've gotten rebates, those come from Metropolitan and Three Valleys Municipal Water District to you. All those things have helped us reduce our per capita water usage by 40%. That's remarkable. But yet there's more that we need to do to ensure that we have a reliable water supply for our future generations. And so this regional recycled water program is part of that solution. So let's talk about what it is. It's a new supply of water that's coming from our used water. So currently, when we use wastewater in our homes, businesses, and industries, it flows to a wastewater treatment plant. In LA County, there's a number of wastewater treatment plants, but one of the largest is located in Carson. It's called the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant. And you can see a picture of it here and under number two. And that water that's currently cleaned at the sanitation, it belongs to the sanitation districts of Los Angeles County. Once they clean that water, it goes off the coast of the Palos Verdes Peninsula into the Pacific Ocean. And so what we're planning on doing with this program is taking that water and then purifying it. So cleaning it up to basically drinking water standards at an advanced water treatment plant, and then taking that purified water and reusing it by sending it to our groundwater basins to help refill those basins. We rely heavily on them in Southern California and in Claremont as well too. They make up about 30% of our water supply overall in Southern California. We also could send those waters to industries that use a lot of water in their industrial process. And then the third thing that we're looking at is sending that water directly into our drinking water system. So into our water treatment plants, where it could combine with those imported supplies coming in from Northern California and from the Colorado River. And going through that water treatment system and into our delivery system to our member agencies, to homes and businesses and industries to continue that cycle again. And so in terms of numbers, this is a big, big program. It would produce up to 150 million gallons of water a day. In the water industry, we measure water in acre feet. And I don't know if an acre foot is what it sort of sounds like, but I love showing this visual because it just allows you to think of it. And if you love football, even more so in terms of a football field. So it's about an acre in area. So that's the size of a football field, a foot high, almost 326,000 gallons of water. And it's enough water for three families per year. Fun fact, when I started working in the water industry back in the 1990s, I was actually working in the wastewater industry, but an acre foot of water was enough for one family per year. So again, that shows what conservation has done, how much more efficient we are about our water usage in Southern California. But back to our regional recycled water program numbers here. So 168,000 acre feet is enough water for over 1.5 million people. That's about the same amount of people in the entire city of Philadelphia. And it would be one of the largest programs of its kind in the world. And this is really exciting for us at Metropolitan. Again, this is the first time we're looking at a local water supply that we would be providing, not just providing through our member agencies and, you know, stepping away or in addition to those imported supplies that we already provide. And the program has tremendous benefits. So it has economic benefits, environmental benefits, and water supply benefits. I'm going to start with the economic benefits. It would provide, this program would create over about 50,000 jobs in the region. So we recently just did a study with the LA Economic Development Corporation. They took a look at what the investment in this program is in terms of capital costs and annual O&M costs. We're going to do a deeper dive into the costs in just a few more slides. What we get in economic output, so the capital costs of the program are currently estimated at about $3.5 billion. And what we get in economic output is almost three times that. And then the number of jobs created is phenomenal too. So it's really, truly an economic gift for the region. And that study did not even look at what the benefits would be of not having that water supply, if that makes sense. So if we don't have water, you know, industries, people all leave. So providing that water also allows those certain industries to grow. It didn't even look at that. So again, huge benefits, environmental benefits. Of course, we're reusing a water supply that's currently flowing to the ocean. So huge benefits to that. Also the purified water that would come out of this program would also help water quality in our groundwater basins. And then the water supply benefits. I do want to go deeper into these. So again, this is a drought-proof supply, provides water to us, rain or shine. We don't have to worry about, I look at the weather forecast so much, not just in Southern California, but also in Northern California, also in Colorado, just to see what our imported supplies are doing. We wouldn't have to worry about any of that. As long as we're using water in our homes and businesses, we've got our water supply from this program. It's local. That also makes it seismic resilient for us, because if there are imported supplies cross over the San Andreas fault to get to us, so if there were a big earthquake on the fault, those supplies could be impacted, but this supply would be available to us. And then, as I mentioned before too, it helps replenish our groundwater basins, which are such a critical supply for us here in Southern California. So a closer look at our source water here. I mentioned the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant. It's operated by the LA County Sanitation Districts. They're our major program partner on this program. This plant here, so this aerial photograph kind of takes a closer look at this facility. It's located just east of the 110 freeway off of Sepulveda Boulevard, if you're familiar with the Carson area. Again, a really big wastewater treatment facility. It gets 260 million gallons of water in every single day. And as I mentioned before, all the water goes to the ocean once it's been cleaned. This is the largest untapped source of wastewater in the region and actually off the West Coast. So if you look at all of our water supplies that are going off into the Pacific Ocean, this is the largest flow. So this is provides a tremendous opportunity for Metropolitan. When we're pursuing a new water supply, we want to make sure that it has regional benefits. And because of the large flow of this facility, it allows us to do that. So our full-scale advanced water treatment plant that we would be constructing, there's a rendering here on the right that you can see, but we're looking at a three-step purification process, and we're actually currently operating a demonstration facility. I did not point that out in the last picture, but the orange you see here is the demonstration facility we're currently operating. We're looking at constructing our full-scale facility on the site of the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant, and this dashed line here shown in the yellow. And our full facility, we're looking at putting in a three-step purification process. And this is what we're testing right now at our demonstration facility. It consists of membrane bioreactors, reverse osmosis, and ultraviolet light and advanced oxidation. These are advanced purification processes that remove basically anything and everything in the water. So bacteria, viruses, you can see the list here, PFAS chemicals, pharmaceuticals, other compounds to produce water that's near distilled in quality. So pure, in fact, that we would add minerals back into the water after this purification process to ensure that the water is stable. So when you put it into a pipeline, pipe materials don't leach into it. That's how pure it is. It's if you took that water and you put it straight into a pipeline, all those pipe materials would dissolve into the water. And here is a map view of this program, so you can kind of get a sense of what it looks like. We call it the Regional Recycled Water Program for a reason. It truly is regional in nature. So again, the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant operated by the sanitation districts down here in Carson, our advanced water treatment facility in the Carson area as well. And then we're looking at sending the water to four groundwater basins, the West Coast Basin here in pink, the Central Basin here in green, the Orange County Basin here in purple, and then here to the main San Gabriel Basin in orange, 37 miles away from the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant. And we would be using a combination. You can see here, the map mentions spreading grounds and injection wells. So spreading grounds are just large open areas where you mix right now imported water supplies with stormwater to help refill those groundwater basins, but we could replace some of those imported supplies with this purified recycled water instead. And then injection wells are just sending that water straight into the ground. And then in the future, as the state develops regulations that allow us to put that water straight into our drinking water system, we would send that water to our Weymouth Water Treatment Plant, which is located in Laverne, which is just a short distance away from the Santa Fe spreading ground. So those are at the 605 and 210 freeways. Our Weymouth plants, like the 210 and 57 freeways, in Southern California, you always have to use your freeways as your landmarks. And then we have an existing pipeline already that we would use to send that water from our Weymouth Water Treatment Plant down to our Deamer Water Treatment Plant in Yorba Linda. And then we could send that water from there. We already have existing pipeline to send that water to the Orange County basins. We would need to construct a new pipeline, so a big pipeline, 7 feet in diameter, between the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant and the main San Gabriel Basin. So that's something that we're looking at too, is how could we construct this pipeline to limit our impact to communities? I actually think I have, oh, I don't have that map. Okay, but how to limit our impact to these communities along the way. And so we're looking at using existing right-of-way, like Edison has a lot of right-of-way along the San Gabriel River. So we're looking at maybe we can use that, and then that would really take us off city streets as we're constructing this new pipeline. And then a program of this scale requires a lot of partners. So you can see here our wastewater partner, the LA County Sanitation Districts. We're working with the groundwater basin managers. So in Southern California, our groundwater basins have been heavily managed by the water replenishment districts. So they manage the central basin, the West Coast basin, and then the main San Gabriel water master manages this main San Gabriel basin. And then our metropolitan member agencies who rely on those groundwater basins and who would also have some of these program facilities in their service area. So with all the agencies that you see here, we have letters of intent or agreements to work with all of them. So including your local member agency, Three Valleys. And then I mentioned how we're working with Edison to see if we can partner with them and use some of their existing right-of-way. We're looking at using public work facilities and Army Corps facilities as well too for our conveyance system and this program. And then last but definitely not least are our Colorado River partners. So this is really interesting. I mentioned in the beginning that the Colorado River has been on a long-term drought, and Lake Mead is at its lowest level it's been since we started filling it. And so we have been working with other users of Colorado River water for years. So the Southern Nevada Water Authority, the Central Arizona Project, the Arizona Department of Water Resources. One of the things, for example, we do with them, and we've been working with them to see what we can do to better manage our Colorado River supplies. So for example, one of the things that we all partner up and do is we pay farmers to fallow their land so they don't use in the Palo Verde Valley, which is right next to the Colorado River. So that way we're able to all conserve some of that those supplies. Well, they have indicated that they want to partner with us on this program. So if we start using these purified recycled water supplies, we also reduce our demands on the Colorado River. So we have agreements in place with them, and they're willing to fund some of our environmental planning work. And that actually brings me to our program schedule. So we have been working on this program for over a decade. We started working with the sanitation districts back in 2009. We started doing some technical studies to see if we could take the water from the joint plant and convert it into recycled, purified recycled water that could eventually be used for drinking. And then when the answer to that question was yes, we continued on. We did a feasibility study, some conceptual planning studies. Our last huge milestone was last fall when our boards moved to approve the environmental planning phase of the program. What that consists of is doing some conceptual engineering studies for the program to better define the program, doing a more in-depth cost analysis. And the biggest part of that is really producing our environmental documents. So our program environmental impact report for this project. Along with that, we're also doing a lot of community outreach, and that's my job. And so I'm going to talk to you more about that in just a couple slides here. Now, once we have our certified environmental documents, we will return to our board for their approval to begin design and construction of this program. And then startup and operations is expected right now in 2032. So another 10 plus years to go. So it takes a while to get a program like this off the ground and implemented, but we really want to see this through. We're also looking at ways we can speed up some of this design and construction too. And so we're looking for all kinds of opportunities, or if there are short segments of this program, we can implement earlier. And so we're continuing to look at those as well too. Program costs. So I mentioned that I was going to go do a little deeper dive into the cost of the program. Our last cost estimate was done in 2018, and we will be doing an additional cost estimate in this coming couple years as we better define the program and the program facilities. Again, based on our estimate in 2018, our capital costs for the program are $3.4 billion. Our annual operations and maintenance cost estimate is $129 million. It will provide 168,000 acre feet of water. So with all of that, our program costs are expected to be just over $1,800 per acre foot of water. For comparison, our imported water supplies currently cost about $1,100 per acre foot. So this is a little bit more. The $1,800 is, believe it or not, within the range of what a local water supply would cost. So, but we are still trying to work to see how we can bring down that cost even more. So our project partners, the LA County Sanitation Districts, our Colorado River partners have all contributed funds to our environmental planning phase for the program. And we expect those partnerships to continue, and the funding, hopefully, keeping our fingers crossed, to continue. We also plan to go after a lot of grants. So the Infrastructure Investment Act that was just passed through Congress has millions and millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars available for large-scale recycled water programs like this. So we expect to apply for those grants. We also expect to apply for state grants. So again, our goal is to bring down our costs even more so and make sure that this program is affordable for our ratepayers and for the communities that we serve. So I mentioned I was going to talk a little bit more about our community outreach program. Right now, what we're doing is we're trying to get the word out as much as possible about this program. So what's really interesting with recycled water supplies is you can produce, the treatment technology is out there to produce purified recycled water, but sometimes people get a little bit concerned when they hear what the source of the water is, that it's, you know, our used water coming from homes and businesses. And so our goal is to make sure that people feel comfortable with this new water supply, that they know this new water supply is coming. And then the communities that potentially could be impacted by our program facilities and construction, they also would be would get this new water supply, but we especially want to make sure we're working with them so they're aware now that this project is coming and that we start building those relationships now. We continue to build the trust and those relationships for the over 10 years we have to go to implement this program. And so if you have any suggestions of anyone we should meet with and talk to about this program, please let us know. Or if there's a place you think we can get an article in, a newsletter, a newspaper you read, a blog you read, we're happy to reach out to them. Feel free to put it into the chat, or you can even contact me directly. A couple slides to come is my contact information. And then we also have an e-newsletter it's available on our website. I'll try to put it into the chat if I have a chance, but I'll also be sharing a link to our program website and you can go on there and sign up as well too. Please feel free to sign up for it. We also offer virtual tours of our demonstration facility. So if you want to go deeper into the water quality aspects of our program or some of the purification technologies we're using and what's involved in them, we encourage you to sign up for one of those. Our next tours are going to be in the middle of January. And again, I'll try to put that link into the chat also so you have that information. And let's see. So here's my contact information. I'm going to jump back to the discussion Q&A slide, but here is my contact information. So feel free to take a screenshot of this and keep it with you and reach out to me again anytime you have questions. I love talking about this program and about water. I'm happy to talk about it anytime. So again, feel free to contact me. And then this is our program website here. MWDH20.com/RRWP. Again, feel free to take a screenshot and take a look at this website. It has a lot of great resources in it. If you're interested in any of this, I mean, even technical resources. So again, if you want to do a deep dive into all of our program studies, they're all here. There's a number of videos you can watch as well too. So I'm going to take it back to here. And I'm going to go ahead and I guess
you can leave it shared if you want, or you could, either way, if you want to. Rupam, is it okay if I go ahead and read through some of the questions that we have in the chat box?
Sure, absolutely. And maybe I can set it up this way so we can all see each other.
There we go. That works. Okay, so the first one, I think you answered this like the slide after it was put in, but it asks from Richard Haskell, is this a program, a collaboration with LA County Sanitation District? And I think you had a slide alluded to that right after.
Yeah, absolutely. So the LA County Sanitation Districts have 11 wastewater treatment plants. 10 of those 11 are already water reclamation. They're already recycling the water from their plants. This was kind of their only ocean discharge facility, and they were looking for a partner to work with them to reuse this water. And so it's really been a great partnership. And I actually used to work for the LA County Sanitation District. So for me, this program is like full circle. It like combines all of my experience and my interest into one.
Great, nice, great. And then another question from Carol Lee. What communities in California already use this type of system, if any, or what communities throughout the US, or is there a model like this that we can kind of draw upon for comparison?
Yes, and I actually have a slide. So I'm gonna maybe try to share my slide, my deck again, because I actually have one that shows all the programs in California here. Let's see, this one. Let me try to put this into show mode. There we go. So you can see there are a lot of programs, recycled water programs in California. And California, by the way, is a leader in recycled water across the world. So the first, let's see, in Southern California especially, the first water recycling program in the United States was actually in Southern California. It was from the LA County Sanitation Districts. They constructed a facility called the Whittier and Narrows Water Reclamation Plant back in 1962. That plant is still in operation today. All the water, or the most of the water from that plant, goes to replenish the groundwater basin, the central basin. And so that again, that was the start of it. And from there, recycled water has just really taken off. So this is pretty common in California, and you can see so many different facilities. The Orange County facility, Orange County Water District, has a system called the groundwater replenishment system. That's currently, I mentioned that our program would be one of the largest of its kind in the world. That currently is the largest of its kind in the world. So they are right now expanding it. It's at 100 million gallons per day. They're expanding it to 130 million gallons per day. And again, we're looking at 150 million gallons per day. So that's another one I want to point out. Right now, the city of Los Angeles is also pursuing a big program like ours. It's called Operation Next, and we're also working with them to see if there's opportunities to have our two pipeline systems connect in certain points, so it would provide even a larger recycled water program. And then let's see if there's San Diego has a program that's in construction right now, and it's expected to go online pretty soon. So you can see everyone is drinking recycled water throughout the state.
Great, thank you. And then we've got a question from Elise Free, sort of a two-part question. The first is, since the facility would serve 1.5 million people, if she remembers correctly, would the idea be to create additional facilities in the future? Sounds like there are already a lot of facilities like this, but are there any other plans within LADWP, Metropolitan Water District? And then what are the energy requirements of this type of facility? And are those going to be met through renewable energy, or, you know, if you could speak to the source of power for these types of projects?
Yeah, great questions. So, what this program would do is it would just provide an additional water supply in our region. So it's not, we have water for our service area, and this would just kind of help us diversify our water supply, so we have more reliability and resiliency in the future. So that's what it is. I think it helps visualize, like, the 1.5 million people just helps visualize sort of like how much water we're producing. But yeah, there are others are pursuing this. This is the future of water in California, and honestly across the world. You're seeing a lot of other regions that may never before have considered recycled water, but because of population growth and climate change, they're taking a look at it. So you look at, especially in the West, you know, you look at Idaho and Washington, Hawaii, Colorado, there's a lot of regions that are looking at this type of water for the future, again, to just provide that water reliability. Especially because of climate change and climate change impacts. And then in terms of the energy usage, so there is energy usage required. There's energy usage that comes both ways. So I talked about the purification process. And the purification process, there's this one step, reverse osmosis, which is pretty common to advanced water treatment facilities that produce purified recycled water. It's also very common in desalination facilities. It's really like an effective process. It's able to remove all kinds of constituents from water, but it is energy intensive to do that. So reverse osmosis uses quite a bit of energy. And then the other thing that uses a bit of energy is just getting our water where it needs to go. So I'm going to take it back if you don't mind. It's so much easier to visualize. Oops, here we go, right here. So the way our wastewater system was built in LA County was it was built to flow downhill to the wastewater treatment plant. So the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant is located in Carson in a lower elevation region of the county. But then to get the water to where it needs to go and where it would be used, you do have to pump up water uphill. So there is energy usage associated with that to get that water all the way up here to the main San Gabriel Basin. And there's also, as you see here, a couple of junction structures, but there's also a couple of pump stations. So there's like a pump station here, and there's also a pump station up here in the main region here. So that uses energy as well. One of the things we have done, and actually it was initiated with our initial work on this program, is we currently have a draft climate action plan that we've put together at Metropolitan to look at our energy usage for this program, as well as all of our facilities and how we can offset our greenhouse gas emissions. That climate action plan is actually out right now, currently for review. So it's in that review phase for public review. I do encourage you to go onto our website and to take a look at it. And maybe I can put all these things in the chat, or Stuart, if I don't get to it because I'm talking and sometimes I have difficulty multitasking, I will email it to you. Is that okay? And then maybe you can share it with the group. So please take a look at that if you're interested in looking at our plans to be carbon neutral throughout Metropolitan. And then otherwise, we are looking at what we can do to use renewable energy of sources for our energy usage. So currently, some other fun facts, the sanitation districts, when they process their solids, like all the wastewater solids, so the waste that comes out when they clean the wastewater, they also take in food waste too, that's collected from facilities like stadiums and restaurants and grocery stores. All of that material they take at the Joint Water Pollution Control Plant, they put it in these things called anaerobic digesters, it's a biological process, and it processes these solids and it produces methane gas as a byproduct, a biogas really. That biogas is collected and it's all converted into energy, into electricity. So it makes the entire Joint Water Pollution Control Plant energy self-sufficient, and they actually have some excess energy on site as well too. So we will tap into some of that excess energy they have to operate our facility. At some of our other Metropolitan facilities, we put in solar panels, like at our Weymouth Water Treatment Plant, we have solar panels. We'll look into that. And then as much as possible, we're using whatever renewable energy is available to us, and trying to be as energy efficient as possible too.
Okay, great. And I plugged in what I think is the current draft plan from the NWD website.
Oh, you found it. Great. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. And then we got another question here. Let me hold up. Will the project ultimately provide enough water so that we will be self-sustaining if using currently available sources? And that's from Carol Lee.
So will it provide enough water that we will be self-sustaining? If we'll still need to rely on our imported water supplies, those are really still important to us, but it will just provide, it's just going to maximize our use of our imported supplies. So those imported supplies will come down to us. We'll use them and then keep reusing them, but also continue to import supplies as well too.
Okay, and then from Richard Haskell, will any of this water make it out to Claremont? We have historically been discouraged by LACSD from reclaiming our wastewater to use for irrigation. We could probably do this for less than $1,800 per acre foot. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I think it will. I don't know, Matt, Brian, do you want to answer that question, or do you want me to take it?
Matt, you got your hand up. You could unmute yourself.
I can take that question real quick. I guess there's two categories that I'll put this in. This project will provide water directly to Three Valleys and indirectly. And what I mean by directly is one of the programs that we will be providing water for is the main San Gabriel Basin for recharge obligations. And for every acre foot of water that we put in the ground through this project in the main San Gabriel Basin, frees up water to be used elsewhere, such as in Claremont. So if you look at it from a holistic approach, you know, the overall supply demand pie chart, so to speak, the water that this project produces offsets demand on other sources that we use. So indirectly, yes, it does benefit Claremont. As far as actual molecules of water reaching Claremont from this particular project, not necessarily. However, when the wastewater or the potable water Regulations are approved by the state, and Metropolitan can actually put water into the Weymouth treatment plant for treatment. There is a direct molecule benefit that benefits some of our member agencies, just by fact of the geography of where Claremont is, that molecule of water doesn't get to Claremont. However, again, it still offsets demand that that we have to meet that would offset anything that would go to Claremont. So anything that this project produces will definitely benefit Claremont, but mostly from an indirect standpoint. So I hopefully that answers your question.
Great, thanks for that, Matt. Thanks for jumping in. And then we have a question from Jan Bush. Rupam, it's exciting to see a regional scale program to use wastewater for potable supplies. That is the future. But I want it all. I want a restored San Gabriel River, restored to seasonal flows that sustain native plants and fish. Currently, the river is dominated by waste flows from wastewater treatment plants, I think is the acronym, as I understand. How can MWD help the river acquire protected supplies as the Carson project comes online? Sorry, that was a mouthful. Hopefully you got that.
Yeah, I actually think I'm going to read it, if that's okay. Oh, yeah, here. I can see it. Great. You want to restore San Gabriel River, restore it to seasonal flows. Wow. Jan, I got to get back to you on that one. I don't even know how to answer. I keep thinking, but if anyone else wants to, again, I'm going to call on Matt and if you want to add anything, but if not, I will get back to you on that because I also work a lot with the LA County Sanitation Districts and I know that they are, many of their plants discharge to the river. So I think that they might, and I'm not really so too familiar with all the activities along the San Gabriel River. And so I just would need to look into that and get back to you if that's okay. And if you don't mind, you can put your contact info into the chat and then I'll have it. Or maybe what I'll do is I'll put my contact info into the chat and you can reach out to me.
That's great. And Jen, that sort of sounds like a great dialogue topic in its own right too, down the road, if we can't find somebody who can come speak to that. Great. And then while you're putting your information in there, let me see if I could go to the next one. We have another question from Freeman. I think you and Matt sort of addressed this. Will Golden State Water sell this water to us and who will set the price? And so I don't know if Matt or Brian, if you have anything else to add to that or Rupam.
That's really a tough one because Golden State still feels that the wastewater is their water. And how that's going to come out on the legal issue, I'm not sure. But I will tell you that it is a probability that we could work something out. I'm probably more leaning towards, if I had to pick different projects, I'd be leaning towards the stormwater project more than I would the recycling of sewer water, and at least in the Claremont area. But it's not out of line. And I know what Freeman's talking about because we've been working that a long time, and Southern Cal or Golden State rather. Golden State still feels that they're involved in it because it's their water. I totally disagree with that. So, and I'm not afraid to say it, but that's gonna end up, whether it's legal or not, in court or not, I couldn't tell you, but I know that if we could put a package together, I think it would come in a little cheaper. And that leads up to the question that I have for Rupam. The price you gave of $1,800 and some dollars for the water, that's at Carson of what you're producing there. By the time you push it from Carson all the way up to the San Gabriel Basin, that's a big push. So is $1,800 as the water is treated at the expense of treating it and then pushing it all the way up to the San Gabriel Basin, or is the $1,800 at the San Gabriel Basin going back? The reason I ask that is I've already figured it out from when you guys started the plant, because I'm going to be 99 years old when I get to see the first water come through there. And I plan on living that long. So just to tell you. But what I'm looking at is when it gets all the way to the San Gabriel Basin, there's going to be a cost, whatever that is. I think it's going to be cost plus whatever the 1800 is. From there, the project then will continue and go over to the Weymouth plant. And looking at who your partners are and knowing who your partners are, Edison is going to be very involved, because I would think at that point, when you get at some point, when you get to the Weymouth plant, it actually free falls, like the water that's at the Weymouth plant now. There's a 50 million gallon reservoir there. So you take that water and it's actually free falling into the Orange County area. So I'm assuming that, and this is a big an assumption, but I'm thinking that maybe Edison will then join in with us, and Metropolitan will be building about 3 or 4 or 5 hydro stations along the way, all the way down to Orange County. And if you really think about that process, in the overall scheme of things, the cost of that water from the Carson plant working its way up the San Gabriel River into the basin, across to Weymouth, and then down back down to Orange County, there's going to be a substantial savings there. Even with, you know, the small hydros that we have, we know on a very small scale what we're making off of it right now under the contracts with Edison. So I'm assuming that, you know, a 7-foot diameter line, you could put a lot of water through there and you can make a lot of money off the energy. And I would hope that the partners, meaning Southern Cal Edison, will pony up and be a part of that. And again, I'm hoping that I'm still around at 99, because when it gets to that 2032 age, you know, I plan on still being here, because I'd love to be able to see the final product, even if it just gets to San Gabriel Basin. I would love to see that. But I think out here, I think we're doing, Stuart, maybe just to take a second, but I think what we're doing and what people have that I'm looking at on the screen are mostly from Claremont. I see a couple from the Conservation District, but the answer to what we have here is exactly what Matt was talking about earlier. We're looking ahead. We're looking at our future. And Matt has already, we have another well going in. We've had 3 wells go in just the last few years. The third one's going in at Grand and Miramar. And when that one goes in, Matt is jumping on it. We'll have it there this summer. So we're looking at local arrangements. And then what we do there, along with 6 basins, which is the water in the upper Claremont Basin, the lower Claremont Basin, it's coming out of the San Antonio Dam area. But we're looking at water coming there. It's not a lot, but it is some. So you take that combination and what Matt's doing with 3 valleys on our new wells, those are going to, it's going to be a big deal to us. And even if this water that Rapam is talking about gets all the way to the Weymouth plant, I just don't feel that it's going to be, you know, like Matt said, we'll be able to supply Walnut, the Cal Poly area, we'll be able to do Glendora, we'll be able to do some of that area over there. It's not going to come to Claremont. And even if it gets to the Weymouth plant, somebody would really have to have their head screwed on a little bit different, because from the Weymouth plant, getting it back up, we're sitting at 1,850 feet at three valleys. Down here, we're sitting at Weymouth plant, we're only at 900. Now, somebody's got to pay to get that water up the hill. And I don't want to be the one to pay for that. So I'm more interested in spending $1.5 million on another well and producing what we can on a local basis and leave that water to the agencies to the south, whether it's South Pomona, Walnut, Diamond Bar, Roland, Covina area. That's where it needs to go. It's not going to help. I really and truly believe that it's not going to help Claremont. And I want to make that really clear, because I don't want people to leave thinking that this is the greatest project since ice cream and Rapam is going to give us all this water. It ain't coming here. But I think we as the directors up there with Matt, we're doing a a superb job trying to look ahead, you know, and I'm not talking 5 years or 10 years, I'm looking at 20 to 30 years minimum, and trying to bring that water to us. So that's where we're at. And I just, I really want to, because I heard and read some of the questions, I want to make sure that everybody understands the water is not going to come to Claremont. But as Freeman said, there's an opportunity that we have just picking up the water. Everything north, and I'll just put it this way, everything north of baseline, it's all residential. That's good, what I call good clean water for wastewater. And that could be cleaned up very easily with very small units and take all that water and be able to reuse it. And so we're looking at a lot of different projects and we're working with a lot of different people throughout Claremont. So I just wanted to make that clear. Rupam, I'm not trying to take anything away from you. Believe me, you do a great job for what you do over there. I love you.
Oh, thank you. No, I think we're all trying to do the same thing, that make sure that our region has water for the future. So I love hearing about all the projects that you all have planned too.
You know, I got Stuart, if we just have a minute, I got to.
One more quick second, because we have a couple more questions, Brian.
Well, she was talking about, you know, you got to get the message to the people, because people have a real concern over drinking, you know, from the toilet to the tap. You know, that was 25, 30 years ago. That was a big thing. Posters were all over the place, toilet to the tap. Well, things have changed. But it's interesting because every year I take at least two, if not three trips down to this facility. And I take a lot of young men and women that want to get in the water field or are very interested in the water field. And we take them from Claremont High, Laverne, Pomona area, and out of San Dimas. And we take them down there. One of the trips down there is really interesting. After I went a couple of times, we got down there, we went through the pilot program, went through the facilities, and they take you through and they show you all the different types of treatment. And when you get to the end, they have six taps lined up and they have a bunch of glasses there. And the guy takes it and he drinks the water and he says, it's really not that bad. I would like every one of you to take a glass of water. Half of them would not take the water until one of them walked up and said, well, I'll try. So he took it, he drank it, and he goes, you know, that's not too bad. I walked up and I took it and drank it, and I started going, and they all got panicked. But the bottom line is, it's the young people that are out there, the young men and women that want to get in the water field, don't know how to get in the water field, but what we're doing with them, I think, is great. And I promote young men and women to get in the water field. It's a very open field. And I love taking them down to the plant, because I've been down there now, I don't know, 8 or 9 times at the pilot project. And I love taking the young men and women down there.
All right. Yeah, Brian, I'm sorry. I got to keep going. We got a couple more questions here. Rupam, I've got two here from Ross, which I think are very important questions. And we kind of got to a little bit in our previous conversation with Rebecca. The first is, why is water so cheap when it's our most valuable resource? He has it at about 2 cents a gallon. And then the second part of his question is, it seems like there's still a whole lot of conservation needed if a family uses 100,000 gallons per year. And so what else can we do, or what else, including businesses or, you know, commercial, industrial, to really decrease our supply? And I think this came up at our last conversation with Rebecca, where we've made all this progress, but it still seems like not enough is being asked of us. Like, we're, you know, we hear about water shortages, but we're not really told, you know, what to do. We're told to conserve, but not really told, you know, what that means. And so if you can kind of speak to that a little bit, that'd be helpful.
Yeah. So in terms of our water usage in Southern California, I mentioned before where we're doing really great, where we're at reduced per capita usage by 40%. Indoor water use, there right now is some legislation that's being proposed in the state for like setting standards for water use efficiency inside your home. So I think those numbers right now are like, they're looking at 50, 55 gallons per day, something like that, inside your house. And so where a lot of water usage comes in is with outdoor water use. So if you notice, one of the first things that happens when there is a drought, and if you start with voluntary conservation, people will say, you know, one of the first things that a community might do, I live in LA, and so one of the first things that we're asked to do is to just water our gardens only, three times a week or something like that. That helps a lot. That's where a lot of the water usage is. So if you have thought about taking, if you have a lawn and you've thought about taking it out and using drought tolerant plants, all of that really helps a lot in terms of water usage. And then a lot of new homes, a new housing that is being built is being, it's not like, you know, the huge home with the huge yard. It's more, it's, you know, a lot more urban living. And so I think that also helps with water usage as well. And so if you go to our website, and I'm going to put that in too, I was in the middle of typing it up. I'm going to type it up as soon as I'm done with this, but bewaterwise.com. I'll also throw in the Regional Recycle Water Program website. It gives a number of different rebates you can apply for to reduce your water usage. One of my favorite ones is the new one. It's a pilot program actually that we're starting, where you can put a meter on your home, on your tap at home, and you can monitor your water usage throughout your house. So you can figure out how much water you're using in your kitchen versus your bathroom versus, you know, if it's your kid's bathroom. And maybe I have teenagers who for some reason just love to be in the shower for a really long time. And I don't know what happened. I felt like just last year, they never wanted to take a shower. And then now all of a sudden they're 13 and they just want to be in the shower for half an hour, but I can really track their usage. And you can track leaks too. So you're able to find, like, if you've got a leak and maybe you didn't even know it, highly recommend you go to that website and take a look at those rebates and see what might work for you. And that will really help reduce your water usage. And then, yeah, the outdoor water usage is really huge. In terms of businesses, there's also rebates for businesses to use as well too. So same types of things. We also, sometimes you might be have a type of industry or in a type of industry where it's, we can't just put out a standard rebate for you. So we also do custom programs where we will work with, I mean, we've done things where we've worked with school districts, for example, to reduce their water usage on sports fields, or a specific type of industry to see what kind of water conservation devices we can test and try. So all of that has made a huge impact, and we can continue to make huge impacts just as technology improves, as we're better able to track where we are using water. So I think there's good news on the conservation front. And just to let you know also, I think there's a question about local water supplies earlier. I just want to let you know that we right now, 55% of our supplies are imported. We expect in 2040 for that number to drop down to 65%. I'm sorry, 35%, with 65% being local water supplies. So there's really just a whole shift in water usage in Southern California in these coming years between conservation and local water supplies.
That's great. And then, Rupam, can I ask you to answer one last question that we've not gotten to? And I think we've gotten to all the other ones. Just the last remaining question from Karen Rosenthal. Are you coordinating this project at all with the newly developed Prado Basin Reclamation Project?
Yeah, there are so many great recycled water programs that are coming up. We're not directly coordinating with them in the breadth of the Regional Recycled Water Program, but as we plan for our future water supplies for our region, for our service area, we do coordinate and find out what projects are out there, what future water supplies they will provide. So just again, to ensure that we have that future, where, you know, that your taps are running 24/7, no matter what. So we do have work with all of our eight water agency partners on our water resources here in Southern California.
Great. Thank you so much. And thank everyone so much for such an engaging conversation. So many people in the water biz here tonight. And so it's really great to have such a vibrant crowd, and for all the great questions and all the great information, Rupam, that you provided us. We'll try to get this out on our email list and on our website and YouTube channel in the next day or two. And thank again to everybody for coming out tonight, and hope everyone has a great holiday. So take care, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. You've been a great audience. Appreciate your time. Bye.